G'day everyone, welcome back to Analytical Strategy, and we're going to be talking about the second edition of the pre-merge episode in episode 7 of Survivor 41. And it was an absolutely crazy one to say the least. I mean, the previously on Survivor actually took so long, as it needed to unpack all the advantages in play at the moment to make sure each of them were clear before this episode took place, as so many of them were in play tonight. It was really just a matter of time before the game blew up and went haywire, and tonight was the night. Now for me personally, if this episode was combined with last week's in a 2-hour pre-merge episode, then I think it would have been great, and the viewing audience would have loved it. But I will say, this week almost made up for the disaster of last week, as whilst it was complicated, it was a great episode overall with a crazy finish we saw in the end. So all the advantages in play this episode are, Deshaun has an extra vote, Xander has an extra vote and an idol, Shan has an extra vote and an idol, Nasir has an idol, Liana has a knowledge is power advantage, Erica has an hourglass, and there are also 12 shots in the dark. So altogether we basically have 20 advantages inclusive of these shots in the dark in play at the moment, which obviously is a little bit overkill, but we have to keep all of them in mind to this episode, as each of them have some significance on the game in some way, shape or form. Now as always, let's get into it and let's take a look at some strategic moments which occurred in this wild episode. So let's kick things off with key strategic decision number one. So last recap, I talked about a lot of the negatives from a production standpoint about the hourglass twist being introduced into the game. But I really didn't go into too much depth about what Erica should have done in this circumstance. So I personally absolutely think Erica made the correct decision for her game by smashing the hourglass and becoming immune. Erica firstly considered herself to be a little bit of an outsider on her original tribe, and she also hadn't been to tribal council in any aspect so far in her game, so she really didn't have any confirmation of where she stood in her alliance. So if she thought she was on the outs, getting that immunity is really a no-brainer for her. But I think if someone else went, and even if they felt in a relatively comfortable position, it's still probably in their best interest to smash this hourglass regardless. If you've been put in this position where you're now a 1 in 6 chance of going home, with there being plenty of known advantages in the game, and you also haven't been a part of any conversations when all these tribes are coming together for the first time in this game, your name is going to be mentioned no matter how safe you thought you were, not being on this beach for these 2 days. So the safest thing for you to do is to reset the game, to get immunity, to stay safe, and hopefully be able to shake up the numbers in the next few days. So I think when Erica first stood in front of the castaway saying she couldn't help but feel like she got left behind in the game, being on exile for the past 2 days and nights, and she really didn't have a say in the game as it progressed without her, was honestly the perfect opener prior to her revealing she smashed the hourglass to reverse the history in the game. Again, being left on exile for these 2 days and nights, and with all these decisions occurring around her without her having any input about the following tribal council, where she is one of these 6 people that could go home from the 12. Her name absolutely was going to be in the firing line. I think anyone who went to exile would have been thrown around regardless of who you were. So in short, I definitely think she made the correct play to reverse history and smash this hourglass. And this all ties into key strategic decision number 2, which is just something I want to touch upon briefly, and that is how the castaways initially reacted to this hourglass twist taking place. Now this is relatively insignificant from a strategy perspective, but it still at least plays somewhat of a role, as everything you do in the game conveys information and can give off personality traits that may be used against you later in the game. So I want to talk about 2 contestants in particular, those being Danny and Deshaun. So Danny almost reacted like the viewing audience, he was just absolutely shocked, devastated and pretty appalled about how it all played out, essentially winning this immunity and putting his body on the line for nothing. But from what we saw, he did keep his cool overall, likely a lot more than I would have if I was out there, but still displayed this emotion that this twist is pretty ridiculous, and if you are playing for this immunity in a feast, that should be the prize that you get and it should not be taken from you. He understandably was annoyed, but overall he did play it quite well. But I think Deshaun played this unbelievably well for someone who also looked pretty annoyed about what just took place. I have to give mad credit to Deshaun, who also looked pretty shattered, but he tried to stay optimistic, saying this is not the game he's used to, and he's absolutely right, this is a brand new game, and it's time to adapt or get left behind. And Deshaun was willing to adapt, to stay cool, to roll with the punches and take it all in his stride. He knows although this twist wasn't something he ever expected to happen, or something that he necessarily agrees with in this game, There's no point getting upset about it, and the best thing to do is to look forward and play the cards that you were dealt. So I think it's a huge credit to Deshaun, and I think these are the signs of a high-level player. But overall, I'm sure they all had to have vented about this twist, and this wouldn't have been shown in the edit. But after the challenge, the players up for elimination were Sydney, Evie, Nasir, Deshaun, and Danny, with Ricard being safe, winning the immunity challenge, and therefore being out of the firing line. Now, these are five huge names who I all suspect would have been safe if everyone was up for elimination. So I definitely felt for each of them and the position they were in the game here. So on that note, let's move on to key strategic decision number 3. And this is the first target post-challenge, and this is flipped since the game has been reversed. It initially was Erica, and it now is Evie. So again, the vote is now between Deshaun, Danny, Nasir, Sydney, and Evie, all being up for elimination. And on the surface, this seems like the most logical play for Evie to be the target, as there are 4 original blue members up for elimination and just 1 yellow in Evie, so she definitely stands out from the other castaways listed. With Liana and Shan aligning with Danny and Deshaun as well, those two can easily be pulled in that direction to get those additional numbers for the blue tribe to have this clear majority. Now, this also shows how huge Ricard's win was over Evie in this challenge, as I think if Evie won, I feel like he probably would have been in her position, being this really obvious target. So it was a massive win for him this episode. But with Ricard having this immunity and this win being in play, again from a numbers perspective, without thinking of the advantages we would have, Shan and Ricard still playing together, and those two being linked to Liana via Shan. And then Shan and Liana being linked to Danny and Deshaun, and therefore the rest of the blue tribe. So it's basically everyone in the game against Evie, Tiffany, and Xander on the surface. Now, to me, it was actually a little bit disappointing that we did not get to see much of Erica interact with people after she returned from exile. But I can understand this given once the game was reversed, the numbers were actually pretty clear given how much Evie stood out within this group of 5 up for elimination. But as we know, Survivor on the surface may not show the full picture, especially in this season with all these advantages in play. And the one advantage that really controlled this episode was Liana's. So on that note, let's get straight into key strategic decision number 4. So there is really so much strategy to talk about regarding the knowledge is power advantage. So firstly, Tiffany being able to extract this information from Liana for this advantage in the last episode was huge for the other original yellows in Xander, Evie, and herself, now having the ability to potentially counter this advantage being played against them. The knowledge is power reads, the idol or advantage targeted must be in that individual's possession in order for it to be effective. So if Xander was able to pass it off to someone else before Tribal Council, then it would counteract Liana playing it, which is exactly what happened this episode, but we'll get into that a little bit later. So we did see a couple of little potential missteps along the way with this strategy being executed, so I feel like Xander telling Danny that he knew about Liana's advantage could have been a big, big mistake overall. But I also think he may have done this deliberately to make them think the idol would sit with himself or Evie, and to really take Tiffany out of the equation. I think Xander should have known this information would have circled back to Liana, and then she really should have figured out from this that he would have passed the idol off before Tribal Council. Now, although this is a brand new advantage and we have never seen it in Survivor before, we can still use Survivor history as a basis of an example of how this situation would play out. So take a normal hidden immunity idol for example, and it being an idol that everyone in the game knows about, much like Liana's knowledge is power advantage this episode, and also Xander's immunity idol. So what would normally happen is an alliance would vote for the person least likely to get the idol played on them, as a way to try and counter said idol being played. So if we use that similar strategy and line of thinking for this advantage, the least likely person on the surface for Xander to give the idol to is Tiffany, as a predictable move would be for him to keep it, and the next predictable move would be for him to give it to Evie to play it for herself. The most unlikely thing to do is to give it to Tiffany, which is exactly why he did it. Once Liana found out from Danny that Xander knew about her advantage and that could be played against him, these are the types of tells and common strategies that can be easily picked up on to figure out who has that possession of the idol in the end. But ultimately, we have to give credit to Xander for pulling this off at Tribal, which again, we will delve into further in a little bit shortly. I also think Evie telling Liana about targeting Deshaun could have been a bad move as well here, especially if she thought Liana was against her alliance of herself, Xander, and Tiffany. This again could have given the rest of the castaways time to make a counterplay on this move. which DeShaun himself tried to do prior to Tribal by targeting Sydney, but he looked to have been shut down by Shan, thinking everything would be okay and there was no need to go down that path. There were quite a few missteps here, but overall, I think there are actually a lot of ways the knowledge is power advantage can be played, but also a lot of ways it can be countered, and I personally liked that this advantage was so out in the open so these strategies could be implemented. If you were able to keep this a secret, then this advantage would be so overpowered. So this really goes back to last episode, and really shows how big of a mistake it was by Shan for bringing this up in a conversation in front of Tiffany. If she did not do this, and instead had this conversation with Liana in private, then they easily would have gotten the idol from Xander, and Evie would have gone home. But by saying it so openly, it cost Liana an idol, and it may have even cost them an alliance member as well. And finally, we're going to finish up with key strategic decision number 5, and we're going to focus in on Tribal Council here. And although this tribal was absolutely wild and there's so much to talk about, and we also saw a historic and epic move by Xander, I actually mainly want to focus on DeShaun here. I personally think he really established himself in this game for his performance in this Tribal Council tonight for all the right reasons. He firstly opens up by saying, with this twist in play, although he's happy with how far he made, he wished his social game meant more to the game overall. Again, this is somewhat discrediting how bad this hourglass twist is, but in a way where he stays humble in the process. DeShaun also went into this tribal council, knowing that there was this chance that even with Liana's advantage, that Xander could still play the idol for Evie via an alternate member, such as through Tiffany or even Evie herself. Hence why he attempted to try and come up with the side plan to vote out Sydney prior to Tribal Council even taking place. He then cleverly spills the beans on Evie from his time with her at the summit, in front of Xander, saying he knew about all of Xander's advantages prior to even meeting the guy, through Evie telling him all these details. To me, this was a really smart play to potentially try and sway Xander's decision at Tribal Council to play the idol for Evie. And if not, it could potentially allow them to break up later in the game through this mistrust that he visibly portrayed. But Xander still went through the motions and revealed his fake idol in front of everyone, which honestly was a genius move. And Liana fell right into his trap and attempted to take the idol from him. So once it was all revealed that she was unsuccessful, then DeShaun's original backup plan kicks back into gear to try and put the vote on Sydney. Now this idea really should have been listened to earlier, and if so, no one would have had to have even gotten out of their seats if they took his plan into account, and it would have been a much cleaner tribal council. Having backup plans to your backup plans is what makes a great player, and this is what we saw from DeShaun tonight. But not only this, he knew that him implementing this plan live at tribal council could have made it much more likely that Xander would not play his idol on Evie, due to everyone going crazy and changing up the vote in front of him. So he then decided to switch it back onto Evie, and for a split vote to occur to ensure one of Sydney and Evie went home and that he would be safe. I thought it was a phenomenal performance and an absolutely genius play. It was an insane tribal council, and I really think DeShaun was the main man who was not one, not two, but really three steps ahead of everyone else. And I also have to massively praise Xander for his play as well, and his gut to hold onto the idol in the process. It was probably one of the best all-time idol holds in the game's history. These are the types of players that are exactly what I come to see when I watch Survivor. I think DeShaun specifically is being slept on hard due to viewers not seeing much of the blue tribe to date, and I really think he could be the strongest player in the game at the moment in a really high level cast. He was thinking long term on the blue tribe even when he was winning immunity after immunity, and now when his game is on the line, he really pulled out all the stops to ensure he was safe even after a twist no one could have ever seen coming. His social game is in full force, but his strategic game is also on another level, and I'm really excited to see a player like him progress further in the game. So as we wrap up, we also must mention that we saw the first shot in the dark to be played by Sydney before she went home. And I personally really liked this play by Sydney. It is there to be played, and whilst it did not work out, I think it was the correct decision for her if she thought she was in jeopardy. It was definitely disappointing to see Sydney go out in this fashion. She was a big character, a big player, she had some great moments, and she will absolutely be missed. But that is all we'll be running through this week. It was insanity to say the least. And it will be interesting to see if the deck reshuffles next week, or if the game stabilizes with alliances slightly, or what twists and/or advantages will come in the future. There are still 2 extra votes, 3 idols, and 11 shots in the dark, I believe, so hopefully we'll be set for the next few episodes without any major additions. But as always, thanks to you all for listening. Remember to subscribe if you are new, and to stay tuned for more content coming in the future. This is Analytical Strategy signing out once again, and I'll see you on the next one. Bye for now.